Good morning. Welcome to St. Leonard's and to our service of Holy Communion. Shall we stand as we sing Love Divine or Love's Excelling? Welcome to St. Leonard's, welcome to our Holy Communion. Welcome those of you who are watching online, wherever you are in the world. May this moment be for you a blessing as you come close to the Lord. In notices, Fred, did you want to say something? Pancakes this week. What you want to do is you want to find yourself a grandchild. As an excuse to get yourself into Messy Pancakes, which does what it says on the tin, Messy Pancakes up at St. Luke's. See if you can find yourself a child and come along to that. Else pray for us and the mess that will follow. Ash Wednesday, two opportunities there at 11 and at 6 o'clock for you. This coming Friday, there's a Christian Aid lunch up at St. Peter's. So Nikki has some tickets for you if you would like to know more about that. And can you put a sort of pencil note in your diary for Saturday, the 24th of February? It's going to be, it's the anniversary of Putin's war. And so we thought we'd have another vigil here at 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock on that 24th of February. That'll be both inside here and outside as part of that. Fred.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. And yes, about pancakes. Prayers from my wife, Jane. She's got to do 100 pancakes. No, the reason I wanted to speak briefly was just to let you know where we are with the hall over the other side of the churchyard here. We finally did get planning permission for the development. That's full planning permission, which allows us to sell it with that permission, which maximises its value. And we're moving to sell the place in the next month or so. We start the process with commercial agents. So that's some really good news. It did take a year to get it. We got our money back for the planning application because it was so long, and it wasn't until we wrote to them saying that it's now the anniversary of the permission, what's going to happen. We're going to turn up with an anniversary card for you, we're going to turn up with the press, and then we got a letter, an email back an hour later saying it's approved. That's absolutely true. obviously, as that money becomes available, then we look to start the work here in St. Leonard's Church, because that requires further permissions from ecclesiastical bodies, but that's moving along. We already have the planning permission for the toilet extension. That's the council planning permission. So things are happening. That's the message. And we will start to see in the town some activity eventually on this matter. So thank you very much. I'll leave you to it, James.
So praise the Lord and keep praying. Shall we be still, aware that we're in the presence of God with the people of God to come before God? For we meet in the presence of God, who knows our needs, hears our cries, feels our pain, and heals our wounds. St. Paul says, be imitators of God. Love as Christ loved. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Put away all anger and bitterness, all slander and malice. So then let us confess our sins to God, who forgives us in Jesus Christ. Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like the morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy upon us, deliver us from judgment, bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you stand as we sing our Gloria?
Oh.
collect. Holy God, you know the disorder of our sinful lives. Set straight our crooked hearts and bend our wills to love your goodness and your glory. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for our first reading.
The first reading comes from 2 Kings, chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha replied, "so be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, Elisha. The Lord has sent me to Jericho." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. The company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," he replied, "so be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to the Jordan." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So the two of them walked on. 50 men from the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance, facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry land. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you?" "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet if you see me when I am taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them. And Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel." And Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his garment and tore it in two. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Shall we sing Immortal, Invisible?
Thank you.
standing for the gospel.
The reading is taken from Mark's Gospel, chapter 9, starting at verse 2. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of the Lord.
May my words and our thoughts be in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. What an amazing moment. I wonder what for you has been a most life-changing experience that you've had. I suppose I'm thinking along the lines of positive, joyful anecdotes, memories. For me, I think it could well be holding my firstborn, Ruth. I think something happened in that moment when I first held her, something significant and spiritual that changed me. Yes, there was a lot of joy. There was also a heap load of faith and fear. And as people often say to me, when they're saying about how sleepless nights they endure, I still say I haven't slept well for 26 years. So it continues. 3 disciples, they go up a mountain with Jesus and they will have this life-changing experience. They will not come down the same. And it's not easy to talk about it, to process this, but it is worth the trying. Jesus, up this mountain, transforms from being a carpenter, a teacher, a worker of miracles. We read even last week how Jesus was the light of all humanity. This is the light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. This is the light that gives light to all people. This is the one who called himself the light of the world. And now Peter, James, and John get to see this awesome moment. There will have been joy in it. But also, I can see why their reaction might well have had fear. This is a proper, full-on, awesome moment. This will shape how you see Jesus, how you pray. It might shape how you receive Holy Communion shortly. It might well change us in all sorts of ways that we hadn't thought of. Perhaps it will shape how you see others around you. They too have this light. Is there any chance that we might catch a glimpse of God's light at work in them? Perhaps it might change how you see yourself, particularly in not being quite so hard on yourself, but allowing this joy, this light, this space to shine. And I realize, of course, that we are good and proper English, which means that we will sit politely through this profound and erudite sermon, but actually, at least half of you should be on your feet whooping it up in praise and hallelujahs in a way that would embarrass our Pentecostal brothers and sisters, whilst the rest of you should be flat on your face on the floor in silent adoration and worship. This is proper awesome. Peter sees Jesus talking to Moses and Elijah, and his reaction to this is, let's build some boxes. Let's build some boxes for you 3. Now, I get that. If you've ever had a mountaintop experience, then you want to stay there as long as possible. You want this moment to last forever. It's superb and wonderful. I get that. And so you want this to last forever. Let's build some boxes to keep it all in. But we do have to come down. When these disciples come down, they will go straight into praying for an exorcism. So that's going to shake them a bit. You'll notice that Jesus is talking with Elijah and Moses. And then you'll note they died quite a long time ago. They never knew each other in this life. Moses died perhaps 1300 BC. Elijah ascended perhaps 900 BC, something like that. So here's the weird thing. To Jesus, Moses and Elijah are as alive as you and I are. To Jesus, Moses and Elijah are as alive as you and I are. And that should bring some comfort to you as we remember the saints of old who have been important in our lives. Here's some hope and some joy in the resurrection to come. Jesus is transfigured, shining bright light, and he's talking with Elijah and Moses, and I was wondering, why these two? And what are they talking about? So, Moses. When you hear the name Moses, what are the first stories that spring to mind? Moses in the burning bush, perhaps. That time when God in light appears to Moses in the flames and speaks his name, Yahweh, I am who I am, or I am. And we read in John's gospel how Jesus, being threatened with a stoning because he said, I am. And Jesus spoke of himself as the light of the world. Maybe you remember that Moses is credited with writing the Torah, the rules of the Sabbath. So you can just see Jesus checking with Moses. Are you happy with my interpretation of your Sabbath rules and the alleged breakings of them that I seem to be doing? Maybe with Moses, you think about how he led God's people out of slavery through the wilderness to the promised land. You can find it all in the book of Exodus. And in the Passover, we find the original framework that we will use for understanding the death of Jesus on the cross. Note, if you will, that Moses will fail. He will bring God's people to the edge of the promised land, but God will say no to him entering. He will die because he is carrying too much anger. He has failed. And now, here is Moses in heaven. I like that. I find a little comfort in seeing a failure in heaven. It might be that as you look at the life of Moses, you don't see a failure. Good for you. Quite right. I think that's a kindness. But I also find that encouraging. A lesser known story is about Moses, about how he would go to talk to God in the tent of meeting. And in that tent would encounter the Shekinah glory of God. Cheaply put, you could say Moses met Jesus already transfigured back in the Old Testament. Moses would come out of these meetings and his face would be so transfigured that his face would be so radiant with the glory that people would ask him if he would just put a veil over his face. It's just a bit too much. You're shining a bit too much for us, Moses. Can you just put a tea towel over that? What do you think when you think of Elijah then? Yes, the chariots of fire, which we had in that Old Testament reading. I'm so glad that Margaret picked up the reading when there should be more. Because you're quite right, there should be more, but you've just got to stop somewhere. And it is, it's brilliant, and it goes on to tell more. And you'll just have to pick it up for yourself and read it. It's good. So when we think of Elijah, we think of chariots of fire. We think of the still small voice, that close encounter that Elijah had with God. God, through Elijah, did lots of miracles, many of which are a bit like Jesus and his miracles. And you'll note how Elisha wants to inherit Elijah's powerful intimacy with God. And then you remember how this gift is given by Jesus, not to one follower, not to only those who saw the ascension, but to all who have come to believe, to receive, to listen to Jesus. We'll come to that in a moment. Note also how Elijah spent most of his ministry blessing people who were outside, Gentiles, not part of God's people. Peter, James, and John must be extra overawed in seeing Moses and Elijah. Here is the embodiment of the law and the prophets. Peter might wonder, who is Jesus that he has Moses and Elijah on speed dial? And Peter might see in Moses a reminder of the burning bush, of Moses' own shining face, of the Exodus. And perhaps Peter, seeing Elijah, is mindful of the power of God that was given to Elijah's disciple. So what are they talking about? Jesus, Elijah, and Moses, what are they talking about? It's Luke's gospel that gives us a hint and gives us a peculiar euphemism. Luke says they were speaking of his departure, which he was to accomplish in Jerusalem. Departure, it's an interesting euphemism for death on a cross. Perhaps with this word departure comes with it a hint at resurrection. Perhaps that Jesus' departure is more than just his death, includes his resurrection. Perhaps it includes his ascension. What I didn't realize is the Greek word for departure is exodus. They were speaking about the exodus that Jesus is going to bring about through his death in Jerusalem. There's a lot to process in this mountaintop experience. Oddly, the take-home point is not go get yourself a mountaintop experience. The take-home point is the voice of the Father saying, "This is my Son. Listen to him." Now, the word listen isn't what I mean when I'm giving you the notices beginning our service. And I say something like, now listen up, I'd like you to encourage some of the new people to fill in an electoral roll form. All right? They're over there on the blue. See what I just did there? It's more than that. When God says listen, it's bigger. It's a call to obey, to follow through on what you have received and understood, on what you have heard. So, pick up your Gospels and start reading them. We will spend quite a lot of time this year in Mark and in John, so you can't go wrong there. And over there on the table at the back, curiously next to the electoral roll forms, you'll find some Gospels that you can take away with you, a little pocket Gospel for you. Take a moment to process your own mountaintop experiences that you've had, those ones that have shaped your life. I promise you, it won't be the last mountaintop experience. Pray then for open eyes and open ears and an open heart to be able to receive, to be able to listen. One woman was preaching about a life-changing encounter with God, and she said, you know, it was like God was really there. And then she stopped herself and she said, no, it wasn't. It was like I was really there. I know that God was always really with me, but in this moment, I felt able to be truly present to the divine reality, the glory, the presence that was around me. You don't need a mountain to have a mountaintop experience. You need a little space to settle and pray and realize that God is present with you, right here, right now, in church, in that queue in the post office whilst you're waiting to buy some stamps, in the bustle of the hospital ward, in the noise of parenting and grandparenting. We are none of us ever very far from a mountaintop moment. Amen. Can I invite you to stand and say with me our Nicene Creed? We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Shall we sit for our prayers of intercession?
Loving Lord, still our hearts, and may we sense your Holy Spirit upon us as we pray together. Father, we bring before you those who are suffering so much to follow you. Encourage and strengthen them in their daily lives. We pray for those who serve you throughout your church. May they not be afraid to speak out for what is right and true. In our diocese, we ask your blessing on Bishop Martin and our local bishops, Ruth and Bill. We look ahead and remember those who will be representing us on the General Synod meeting later this month. And today, we pray for your church in South Sudan as they minister to people troubled by sporadic violence, chronic food insecurity, and devastating flood. May your Holy Spirit be upon them all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring all who worship here in our parish and ask you to help each one of us to follow you closely. Be ready to hear your voice and obey your commands, remaining in your love and setting aside time this Lent to seek you afresh. May your Holy Spirit fall upon us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In our cycle of prayer, we give thanks for the work of Samara's aid in Syria, with the provision of a new medical center under the administration of Dr. A. And we ask you, Lord, to enable more doctors to be available to help there. We give thanks for the Beachy Head chaplaincy team and ask that they receive the extra funding they seek so that the chaplains can continue to serve those who end up at Beachy Head in desperate need. May your Holy Spirit be upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for our royal family and ask for healing and a good recovery for King Charles and Catherine, the Princess of Wales. We bring before you the Prime Minister, the Leader of the Opposition, and all the Members of Parliament. Grant each of them wisdom and discernment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for the building of peace between nations, the building of honor and respect between people, as we work through the deep hurts from the past. We pray for the building up of communities in areas where there is hatred and reprisal. Instead, may there be trust and reconciliation. Father, we remember the pain of many throughout the world. We remember families and friends and pray that we can be like your Son, full of compassion and mercy, persevering in our faith. We intercede for those who are ill or suffering, that they might know your healing touch. Father, we pray for those who share their pain. Grant them all your peace. We intercede for those who are dying and those who have died. And we pray for those who mourn their passing. May your Holy Spirit be upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Father, we thank you for the transformation that loving you brings to our lives. We ask that your Holy Spirit will be upon us all and that we will reflect your light amongst those we meet on a daily basis and as members of your church amongst the community around us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you please stand? We are the body of Christ in the one Spirit. We were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We share with one another a sign of that peace. Peace be with you on the camera. Peace be with you, peace be with you, peace be with you, peace be with you. Peace be with you, peace be with you. Thank you, Phil. Shall we sing our next hymn, Christ Whose Glory Fills the Sky? The Lord is here.
It is.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it, gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ our risen Lord. With the whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven, singing. So together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
table is open to all those who know and love the Lord Jesus. So if you would normally receive the bread and the wine, please come forward and receive it here. Having received it, should you wish for further prayer, please do come up into our Holy Spirit Chapel, where someone will pray with you. So come to this table, not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you a right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come not because you are worthy to approach him, but because he died for sinners. Come because he loves you and gave himself for you. Holy God, we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. May we who are partakers at this table reflect his life in word and deed, that all the world may know his power to change and save. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise. When we were still far off, you met us in your Son, brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Can I invite you to stand as we sing our final hymn, God is Working His Purpose Out.
Of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself, the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service, the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ.